Module 7, Beyond Report Development. Module 1 was concerned with the introduction, and modules 2 through 6 were all concerned with authoring your reports. Now let's explore what we can do once the reports have been published. Publishing reports, consuming reports, delivering and embedding reports, and then we're going to wrap up with when paginated reports are likely to be the best fits for your project. We've already seen how to publish the report direct from Report Builder. This requires that you've signed in to Report Builder using the account for your Power BI service. You then save as to the service, and then the report is published. Now, there's likely to be some post-publication tasks. These could concern your data sources. Some sources will require additional steps.
Yep.
I think Azure SQL database requires reapplying the credentials.
That's right. Once you publish something up to the service, you need to ensure that you have those credentials stored, or you're using the option to use OAuth or to authenticate as each user attaching to the database.
Right. And the on-premises sources, there's the time to map to the gateway data sources,
yep,
so the report has its connectivity right down to your data source.
And if you've configured a gateway previously for a Power BI report, you would then do the same type of action you do for a paginated report.
Right. Configuring report settings, there's adding contacts and enabling or disabling comments, depending on what you want. I guess for a sales order report, we might decide that comments isn't a feature we'd want, and yet if it was something like a sales performance report where people had discussions and sharing information.
I think that's more if you have a report that's going to be showing different data to different people, the comments may not be valuable there because people would have different views of the information.
Right. They might look at it and go, gee, sales were really poor, but according to their row-level permissions or the filters that they're applied. Okay, so a time to turn off comments is when people are going to be looking at different data, and it doesn't make sense to share discussion around that.
Correct.
All right, the other consideration post-publication is how will other people gain access to the report? So this is really a topic of Power BI service sharing. And while we won't go into the depths of it in this course, there's the ability to share the report individually to somebody or a security group, or to publish the workspace as an app, or you could use the push approach, create a subscription, and have it emailed to somebody on a scheduled basis.
That's right.
Beyond that, and perhaps more of a developer task, is that the report could indeed be embedded into a custom app or portal.
That's true.
The consumption experience. For paginated reports, it can be done in the Power BI service, with a Power BI mobile app, or with a custom app or portal. So when you're opening the report in the Power BI service, you'll see a menu bar like this, with the ability to print, download, or embed, to export to one of the supported formats, page navigation, open or close the parameters pane, start a conversation with comments, create a subscription, or share the report. In the mobile experience, when you're browsing through to an app or a workspace, you'll note that the reports will have a different icon. Recall that the Power BI reports have that chart-looking icon, and the paginated report have that page chart-looking icon. You've got limited functionality in the mobile app. Specifically, you can identify paginated reports, open them, set parameters, navigate between pages, view the report in landscape or portrait orientation, and mark that report as a favorite for finding easily again next time.
And this is unique to the service. You actually can't view on-prem SSRS reports in a mobile app.
Right.
Yeah.
So only from Power BI service?
That's right.
Delivering reports can be achieved with a subscription, and they can be attached to an email. And each subscription can be run on demand. It can be enabled or disabled temporarily. It could be sent to multiple accounts. You could specify the report format that should be attached, whether it's a PDF or Excel. You could set report parameter values using either the currently rendered ones or to use the defaults that have been defined in the report definition itself. So there's another consideration when defining your report parameters. For the email itself, you can define the subject and the optional message. You can set the delivery frequency anywhere from hourly to monthly. And you can also specify a validity. How long will this subscription run for? Lastly, you can include a link to the Power BI report should somebody want to get to the live report and see up-to-date data.
One thing to keep in mind, and I think you had this question for me, is what if you have a default parameter that uses an expression, like today? And so if you have a set of parameters and some of them are default and they're based on expressions and some you're actually entering information, you can do that and it will use the default parameters as an expression as long as you don't type anything there. So if you were to go into a cell and say, oh, today's date is 4/1/2020 or something like that, as opposed to just leaving it to use the expression, it would then send it based on what you typed versus
the expression.
So this
is in the configuration of the subscription itself. Yes. Just don't touch it if you want the defaults to apply.
That's right.
Great. On the topic of embedding reports, they can be easily embedded by using a link or HTML fragment and URL access. We'll introduce this in just a moment. The programmatic embedding could also be achieved, embedding the report on behalf of users that don't have the ability via Power BI service to get to it directly, but via your authenticated app experience, you could do so. This is well beyond the scope of what this course is about, but there is the Power BI Developer in a Day course, where this is addressed directly with the techniques and methodologies to embed all content, including paginated reports. So what we see here is the file menu, the ability to print, download, and relevant to the embedding discussion now is the embed link and the generate link.
Yep.
What's the difference between the two, Chris?
So the embed link is if you want to use the secure embed capabilities that are in Power BI today. So this is a simple way to embed a report inside your application or internally, something like SharePoint. You want to quickly add an embedded paginated report, you can do that. The generate link is there specifically for the scenario where you're using URL parameters. Because you can have a number of different parameters and we support having, say, multiple values in your parameter, having people type out that string by hand can be quite arduous. So what we've done is we've added this generate link, which will actually generate the link in the format with all of the parameters there that you can use, say, in a Power BI report and set up a drill through between the two.
Great. Well, then that brings us to URL access, which you just mentioned. So the ability to manipulate the URL and to inject different parameter values or commands to render differently. So setting parameter values, hiding or showing the parameters pane, specifying the export format. And for each format, there are multiple device info properties about precisely how that PDF should be generated. They can all be controlled through the single URL.
That's right.
This is all well documented online, and so we don't go through the numerous options that you have available right here in this presentation. Well, we've pretty much arrived at the end of all of the theory that matters for paginated reporting. And I guess the outstanding question that you might have is, well, when is it suitable to do so? You know, we started the presentation by contrasting the two report types, the Power BI report that was really emphasizing interactive analytics and the paginated report that was emphasizing pixel-perfect report rendering suitable for printing or output to PDF. So we would suggest that you consider using a paginated report when it must be printed or output as a PDF document. Data grid layout. So we had a good look at the tablix and we discussed that these data regions could expand. The table vertically, the matrix potentially horizontally and vertically. So here's the thing about that. You've got more control in a paginated report, whether you're going to print it or choose a different format like Excel to get stylized output. Which is very different, isn't it, from Power BI when you export data to Excel.
Yeah, in fact, one of the biggest asks I hear from users is, hey, I would really like to be able to put my Excel or export my Power BI table as an Excel and keep all that formatting. And as I mentioned earlier, the challenge with Power BI reports is you're only going to get a picture of that screen of that particular tab. So that's not an option that you'll have, and to actually go and create that like we do in RDL would be, you'd basically be rebuilding what we're doing already with a paginated report. So that's something, if you're trying to get that capability there, this is where a paginated report can be very, very valuable. And a lot of customers use those URL parameters in that drill through scenario to do just that. They go from their Power BI report to this nicely formatted table that they can go and export out.
So you've got this seamless experience between the two types.
Yes.
So use the type that makes most sense to the report experience that you want. Now, of course, it probably goes without saying, but if you already have investments in SQL Server reporting services or indeed Power BI Report Server, the RDL reports you've created there can be opened up in Power BI Report Builder.
Yes.
And providing that you're not using capabilities that aren't supported. So specifically, just to rattle off a few, like shared data sets and shared data sources are not a concept that paginated reports in Power BI have, but you may have built solutions over these inside SQL Server reporting services or Power BI Report Server. So the investments you've made, providing the data sources are supported, are most likely able to be migrated. And that's just a matter of opening in Power BI Report Builder, adapting if necessary, I think when you save, you'll get an error report if there's features that aren't supported, and then you'll continue on providing those paginated reports through the service and extending the reach of those reports right through to mobile devices.
And we have created, there is a migration tool that we have available online. It's on GitHub, and it actually does, one of the things it will do is it will take see if your report has a shared data source and shared data set in it, and it'll convert those to actually be embedded into the report. And again, if you're connecting against SQL Server, for example, that's a supported data source, we'll actually convert that and allow you to save it up to the service, and it'll just iterate through all of those files in a particular folder and save them to a workspace.
Right. So the last point we'll make about when to use paginated reports is simply that there are features and capabilities that just work in your favor. What could they be? Well, let's list them out.
Okay.
You need print-ready reporting. You want a choice of renderer formats and quality rendering. You want precision layout right to the fraction of an inch or centimeter. Dynamic layout. So by that, we mean expression-based ability to hide and show.
Yep.
Render-specific layout, that if it renders in Excel, it should behave differently from HTML. Per-user layout. So remember, the user ID allows you to interrogate who they are and that your expressions can adapt the format and even the data to produce a different experience. You can work with native queries. That means that you're crafting SQL queries directly against the provider. You've got graphic query designers if you don't have those skills. We have the static data sets that we can use in specific circumstances. Data integration is a great one. You can have multiple data sources in the one file.
Including multiple Power BI data sets.
Right, and you can even integrate. So what you do have is a restriction that the data regions are bound to a single data set, but there are functions like lookup,
value,
that can, with custom fields or calculated fields, allow introducing data between the data sets. Pretty powerful. Parameterization, and we saw all the different scenarios working with multi-select and cascading and defaults. Image data, so the image data can actually come from the database itself.
That's right.
Custom code.
Yeah.
All right. So I love your example of the Azure functions.
Yeah. No, it's a great way to start looking at the latest and greatest you can do in Azure with these paginated reports.
But wait, there's more. Flexible grid layouts. That Tablex, now that was introduced with SQL Server 2008, 12 years ago. And yet, it's still a remarkable way to customize exactly what you need your data to look like. The spatial data types, we introduced the map. What I think stands out here from Power BI mapping is that you can work with the spatial data types in SQL Server.
That's true.
If you've got them defined in your data, they can be rendered directly to the maps in Power BI reports or paginated reports. We've got modern-looking gauges. I still really like them, the radial gauges and such forth with their scales. And HTML rendering of text. And remember the concept that the text box is really a collection of placeholders. And those placeholders allow you to render HTML to give you rich formatting. The text box with those placeholders can also achieve a mail merge.
That's true.
Interactive features. All right, they're not as cool as the Power BI reports, but nonetheless, they're there. So drill down, drill up, tooltips, links. What else do we have? Interactive sort.
But 20 compelling reasons sounds better than 19.
And number 20 is subscriptions. So with subscriptions, the ability for you on schedule to have those reports sent out in email to you or to others.
With full of report attachments. And link.
So I think now we've arrived at the end of the course. And so we have some bonus content, so stay tuned. But as far as the theory is concerned, we've got a demonstration to follow up with what we've just presented. And then stay tuned for some bonus content.
Thanks so much for joining us.